right. Good morning, church. Good morning, good morning, good morning. I'm just going to buy my drummer a few seconds here. Let's start this morning with a prayer. Father, we just thank you for another chance to worship you in this place again. Lord God, we thank you for rain today. We thank you for rain this weekend. I know a lot of farmers are struggling with the drought, and we just thank you that you are providing and watering these crops. We thank you for food, Lord God. We thank you for all those who work hard to provide food for us, Lord God. We just thank you for another chance to be in your house today, Lord God. We just quiet ourselves this morning. We just ask that this time not be in vain, Lord God. Just help us to quiet ourselves to listen to you, Lord God. We thank you. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. We'd like to invite you to stand as you're able. And as we sing this first song, we get warmed up this morning.
Called my name. Well, I was blind and weary, locked down by pain and worry, running circles in a hurry until Jesus called my name. Let the old man fall away, let him fall into his grave. Let the new man rise up in his place because Jesus called his name. Let the old man fall away, let him fall into his grave, and let the new man rise up in his place because Jesus called his name. I would have been so finished, but sin would keep on winning. But it's his plan from the beginning for me to call his name. We worship with elation, sinners to holy nation, when Jesus called our name. Let the old man fall away, let him fall into his grave, and let the new man rise up in his place because Jesus called his name. And let the old man fall away, let him fall into his grave, and let the new man rise up in his place because Jesus called his name.
Church.
Good morning.
God is good.
All
All the time. You may be seated a little bit because we're gonna ask you again to stand up because today is a special day. We are going to introduce people this morning. How blessed are we as a church? Amen?
Amen.
Oh my goodness, are you really blessed? Amen.
Amen.
You are. I can hear now. First, I'm gonna invite Kevin to come up here, and we are going to introduce a special. A blessed people here. Then you can stand there. They can go with you in the chamber.
All right. I have a couple of announcements really quick. First, we have backpacks in the gym for school-age children. So please, if you have not gotten a backpack yet, I am going to be heading that way after these announcements. Please follow me. We can get you a backpack. You can bring it back up here to service. But we want to make sure that everybody needs a backpack for school can get one. Another announcement is that we are looking for adult help in our daycare downstairs in the nursery. So if you happen to have a child that spends time in the nursery, we're looking to get probably 4 or 5 volunteers to be on a rotation. If you feel so called to help in the nursery and help with the children, we have some teenagers that are doing a wonderful job, but we need more adult supervision. So please get with Pastor Eric. Let him know that you would be interested, and maybe we could get you once a month down in the nursery. It would be very beneficial. I do have someone that I want to welcome to the church. We have Michael Jones here. He is our new choir director. He's coming to us via the MSU Music Program. I'm going to have him and his family come up and introduce himself. Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm Michael. This is my wife, Hannah, and our daughter, Olive. On the way, she said, I love church, but by 11 o'clock, she's ready for nap time. We are coming to you from central Iowa, and we've been living and teaching in the Illinois-Iowa area for about 13 years, so this is a big move for us. We appreciate the warm welcome, and we're looking forward to the new adventure and to serving with you here.
Folks, whenever you see Michael, and you have to welcome, you know, some of the folks here, they cook African food, so you can just test those African food. Is that good?
Please.
All right. All right, let us pray for them as well. We did that for the first service, and let's do it for second service. Can you lift up your hand like this, please? Heavenly Father, we come before you to say thank you for sending Michael with his family unto us. God, we pray, may you bless their stay here. May you use them, Lord, to minister to us. May their presence in the city of Lansing, God, be also a blessing in their lives. We praise you, we worship you. Now, in Christ the Lord, when you start something, you'll finish for your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, another announcement is... I'm going to invite all department to come up here. We have got good news coming up. Oh, God. Oh, Jesus.
Morning, church.
Good morning.
20 years ago, I was dragged to Bayshore Camp, which is Sebring, Michigan, up on the Saginaw Harbor Bay. And I have been going ever since. I make this a priority, and you'll hear Pastor's sermon on making God a priority in your life. So I'm really excited to have our Vacation Bible School, which is being brought to us by Bayshore Camp. So we have 6 of their staff. Do you guys want to come up?
Yeah, come up here.
It's going to be an exciting week of learning about Jesus. We have a climbing wall, I think, and lots of other fun things, good food, music, and fellowship. And I think, most importantly, the kids are going to learn about Jesus. So I'll let them introduce themselves.
My name is Sam Yoder. I am the worship director for the camp this week.
My name is Noah June. I am one of the counselors.
My name is Lexi Kilburn. I am the site coordinator this week.
I'm Brennan Keeve, and I'm a counselor.
My name is Amber, and I'm also a counselor.
I am Isaac, and I am also a counselor.
So Lexi's our boss this week. She'll keep us all on track. So Vacation Bible School is kindergarten through those going into sixth grade. So I hope your children have been registered and are ready for a really fun week.
Thank you. Can we pray for them, please? It's going to be a fun weekend, a lot on them. They need Jesus as we need Jesus. Amen? Let us pray. Let us pray for them. Heavenly Father, we come to you to say thank you, God. A day like this, a week like this, Lord, has been known and written by you in heaven. We say thank you for sending your children unto us so that, Lord, we may learn about you. God, I pray according to your word, as you said, it is not by might, but by strength, it is by the power of the Holy Spirit. Let the Holy Spirit, God, give them strength, protect them, Lord, cover them with your love, and use them, Lord, for the glory of your name. We pray, God, for parents as they are sending their children to us. Bless them as well, Lord. We bless you, we worship you, knowing, God, you're going to start with us and finish with us. In Jesus' name, we pray together, and we say, amen. Amen. Thank you so much. There's a video. Do you remember that video? Yeah. Can you play that video quickly?
Feel free to stand and worship with us for another song here before we get started.
Grace, what have you done? Murdered for me on the cross. Accused an absence of wrong. My sin washed away in your blood. Too much to make sense of it all. I know that your love breaks my fall. Scandal of grace, you died in my place. Oh, my soul will live. Oh, to be like you, give all I have just to know you. Jesus, there's no one beside you. Forever the hope in my heart. Death, where is your sting? Your power's as dead as my sin. The cross has taught me to live. And mercy, my heart now to sing. The day and its trouble shall come. I know that your strength is enough. Scandal of grace, you died in my place, oh my soul.
Give all I have.
be seated, folks. Now I'm going to invite the dancer, the Unity Dance, to perform for us.
Back when I had a little, I thought that I needed a lot. A little was overrated, but a lot was a little too complicated. See, zero didn't satisfy me, a million didn't make me happy. When I learned the lesson that it's all about your perceptions. Hey, are you a papa or a superstar? So you act, so you feel, so you are. It ain't about the size of your car, it's about the size of the faith in your heart. There's hope, it doesn't cost a thing to smile. You don't have to pay to laugh, you better thank God for that. There's hope, doesn't cost a thing to smile. You don't have to pay to laugh, you better thank God for that. There's hope. Off in the back country of Brazil, I met a young brother that made me feel that, I could accomplish anything. You see, just like me, he wanted to sing. He had no windows and no doors, he lived a simple life and was extremely poor. On top of all of that, he had no eyesight, that didn't keep him from seeing the light. He said, us are like in the USA, and all I did was complain. He said, living here is paradise. He taught me paradise is in your mind. You know that there's hope, it doesn't cost a thing to smile. You don't have to pay to laugh, you better thank God for that. There's hope, it doesn't cost a thing to smile. Turn on the TV, there's hope. Somebody's acting crazy, there's hope. Let it, it'll drive you crazy, there's hope. But I'm taking back my power today, there's hope. Gas prices, they just keep on rising, there's hope. The government, they keep on lying. We gotta keep on surviving, keep living our truth and do the best we can do, cause there's hope. It doesn't cost a thing to smile, you don't have to pay to laugh, you better thank God. Thing to smile, you don't have to pay to laugh,
Another one. Well, folks, this is not, even God does not feel it. And we need to appreciate people's gift. Amen? We are all gifted in one area or another. Let's give another round of applause for Maquila and Vandita for all the work they do. It takes commitment, discipline, and everything in it to see what you have seen right now. Amen? He has been here in this building, and oh God, sometimes I feel like building a small house for you on the back there, and just, oh, praise the Lord. All right, we're going to take time now to hear the word of God together. All right, folks, before we do that, I'm just going to invite my sister Aleko Mawa to come up here. We're gonna pray for her. She just lost a brother back home in Africa 2 weeks ago. You can come up here, Mama Aleko. It's all right. I'm inviting you to pray for her, and your love and your prayer is very needed. Pray for her and her family back home in Africa. Shall we pray together? Our precious God, Heavenly Father, holy and living God, we come before your throne of grace, acknowledging your presence, Lord. Father, I thank you because you are so good. Even in a moment like this, we are grieving. You are still a God who promised us in the book of Matthew 18, you said, I'll be with 28, you said, I'll be with you to the end of the world. Always. Thank you for being with Aleko, with the whole family back home in Africa. I pray according to your word, you said you'll send a helper into our lives. Send the Holy Spirit, God, to strengthen Aleko, to comfort her, the whole family, God. We bless you, we worship you, God. In this particular moment, God, as your daughter is grieving, use us all as a church to grieve with her. For the glory of your name, we praise you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's take this moment. And folks, if this is your first time to worship with us here, do you have kids that haven't picked up their backpacks? If you haven't picked up your backpacks and you go with... Can you just go in the gym and get your backpack? You need it. School is about to start. If you need a backpack, please. Any kid haven't picked up the backpack, you can go with my sister over there, Angie Tammy. Yes. Next Sunday, okay. Okay. Any kid that doesn't pick up the backpack, can you go and pick your backpack? Yeah, go down in the gym. Yeah. All right. Good.
We'll take care of everything, Eric, and then next Sunday if we need to, we can.
Good. Thank you. Maquila knows. Well, Maquila knows the gym. She has been in this church for many years, many than Pastor Eric. All right, let's pray together. Heavenly Father, I come before you and acknowledge your presence because you are God. Lord, open the floodgate of heaven, pour out your Holy Spirit, God, to open our eyes to see and our ears to hear your word and our heart to receive it. God, as I stand before your children, may you be increased as I decrease in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, folks. All right. Let me put all my papers well. Okay, good. Today, this morning, I'm preaching on the message, enemies that we must overcome. Enemies that we must overcome. Folks, I think we need all to hear this message. God had put this message in my heart for some times now. And I was trying to push hard to the Lord, but I don't have power. God is so big, so he's pushing me harder. And God really put this message for all of us. And the message I'm preaching today is not just directed to anybody. It is not. It is not at all. But I want to preach this morning to the people who have been blessed. Friend, we are the people who have been blessed. We are blessed. Amen? Whether you like it or not, my friend, I'm telling you, you are blessed. Amen? We have been so blessed. Blessing is not only having money, or you are just blessed as you are. We have been blessed. Many times, personally, in my own life, every day when I wake up in the morning, every day in the morning, when I wake up, I open my fridge, the refrigerator, I open like that. I see there's juice, there's water, there's this. I say, my goodness, how blessed am I? Because in the world we are living, there are people who don't have even clean water. And you have a clean water. So I'm preaching to blessed people this morning. I was thinking about this, and I believe it is the truth. I put it in this way. It is easy to give everything to God when you have nothing. But sometimes the greatest enemy that we have to conquer after we have been blessed is to conquer stuff and things that begin to crowd our life and block out what really matters in our lives. Things like stuff and the lust of things can begin to choke out the effectiveness of God's word and God's power. Friend, the challenges sometimes are not the absence of opportunity whom God has been blessed, but it is the abundance of opportunity that can crowd out the plan and the purpose and the destiny that God has and begins to choke out the purpose of the plan of God. We're going to read from the book of Matthew, chapter 13, 4 to 8. I'll read. This is Jesus' parable of the soul, the best soul, and is Jesus telling the disciples. He scattered the seed on the ground. Some fell on the path. Bird came and ate it up. Some seed fell on the rocky places where there was no much soil. The plants came up quickly because the soil was not deep. When the sun came up, it burned the plants. They dried up because they had no roots. Other seed fell among the thorns. The thorns grew up and crowded out the plants. Still other seed fell on good soil. It produced a crop 160 or 30 times more than what was planted. Amen? What a story. When we see in this test, the seed is good. The soil is good. But the Bible says there were thorns that grew up and crowded the seed. Crowded the seed. We are the seed. We God's children. We are God's seed. What God wanted to do through that seed was destroyed. Listen carefully, my fellow brothers and sisters in Christ. And then Jesus said, if you want to know what that means, the parable, here is what Jesus explained now. Jesus explained the meaning of the parable we just read. The verse 22. Now, he who receives seed among the thorns, and he who hear the word, and the cares of this world, the crowdedness of life, and the deceitfulness of riches shock the word, and he becomes unfruitful. Jesus explained it to us. I love that. Help us. Jesus, help us to explain this. The word is sown, but the cares of this life, the busyness and the crowdedness of life began to choke out the effectiveness of God's word. The care of this life and the love of riches begin to choke out God's purpose and plan for our lives. Friend, the world can crowd out the seed of God's word and choke out that which God wants to do. The world is competing, my brothers and sisters, for your gifts. The world says, bring your talents to me, bring your gifts to me, bring your skills to me. And here comes again, God also said, those gifts, those talents, I need them as well. The world needs them, and God needs them as well. There is nothing wrong with the seed, and nothing wrong with the soil. But there is something wrong with the crowd. Here is the point that speaks to the theme of the message today. It is a crowded place, and the care of this life begin to overcrowd, and suddenly God's prophetic word over our lives become a minute and tiny seed. And all of these other things begin to be more important and much bigger in our lives. I want you to understand that one of the greatest battles that you will face in life will not be demons and the devils that you have to fight, but it will be an overcrowded life that suddenly the cares of this life and the materialism of this life begin to become such an important things in your life that God is shrunk down to a tiny seed that is not very effective in your life anymore because of the crowdedness. We are crowded with so many things. In the book of Mark, chapter 5, verse 27, we are told the woman with the issue of the blood could not get to Jesus because it was overcrowded. It was overcrowded. Read the story. There were so many people. It was overcrowded that stopped her somehow. She was desperate that she broke through the crowd and she touched the robe of the Lord Jesus Christ as Jesus walked by and she was healed. And she had to realize this is so overcrowded. It was overcrowded. When you read the scripture, Jesus even stopped by and said, oh, somebody touched me. And the disciples said, no, Master, we have a lot of people around us. He said, no, there's only one who broke the rules, who moved from the crowd and need healing, and he touched me. We are overcrowded. Brothers and sisters in Christ, it is going to take something for us to break out of the care of this life and the deceitfulness of materialism when we need Jesus more than we need anything else. There's another story in the book of Luke. I love the story about Zacchaeus. Zacchaeus, we are told he was a small man. And the crowd was so huge that he could not see Jesus. He was crowded with many people. In other words, his life was overcrowded, and God was wanting to do miracle in his life. Actually, I put a picture of Zacchaeus there. Do I have a picture of Zacchaeus there? Uh-huh. Yeah, it's there. Uh-huh. I love that. And Zacchaeus has to go up and to see the Lord Jesus Christ. And when he saw the Lord Jesus Christ, he was so much blessed. But until he moved from the crowd, Jesus wanted to do miracle in his life. But he was overcrowded with appointment and opportunities. You know, he was a rich guy. He had a lot of opportunities to make more and more and more. But he had to leave the opportunity and to go to Jesus Christ. My life is overcrowded with fun. I know my life is overcrowded with fun. People and entertainment. We love that. Friend, there is nothing wrong with these things necessary. But if we do not watch them, they begin to choke out the critical power of word of God's word and prophetic direction over our life. We get more into the cares of this life and the temporary things, and we forget about the eternal when we get into this crowd. You know, I thought about this guy again, the innkeeper. The innkeeper in Bethlehem with Mary and Joseph. Mary was carrying Jesus Christ, and she was about to give birth to the Savior of the world. And they were knocking doors and knocking doors. And when they knocked onto the innkeeper, and the innkeeper said, "I'm sorry." In the book of Luke, chapter 2, 7, he said, "I'm sorry. I'm sorry, son of man, son of God, there is no room for you. We are overcrowded. There's no room for you because this place is full of people." Oh, God. Do you understand the miracle that wanted to come to their house? If Jesus had been born in that inn. They missed the miracle that was supposed to go to their children and grandchildren because the inn was sold out to other things. It was overcrowded. Jesus never had a room. The inn was overcrowded. Folks, let me tell someone this morning, all the devil wants to do is overcrowded your life. So much that you have no room for revival. You have no room for a fresh start. No room for reading the Bible. You don't even read. You are so busy. You want to catch this. There's no room for you to read the Bible. No room for the Holy Spirit. Because you are entangled with the cares of this life. You are fascinated with the deceitfulness of material things. You want the house, you want the car, you want the land, the business, you want the entertainment, you want the success, this and that. You want all these things. They are overcrowded us. Listen to me, my brothers and sisters in Christ. It is not that we are evil people. But when these things begin to take over our lives and Jesus becomes something tiny that you go and deal with it on Sunday only, and the rest of the week is being overcrowded by the worldliness, then they are enemies after us. They are enemies after us. If Jesus really become your tiny things, you deal with him only on Sunday. Oh, there are enemies after us. I have a question to ask this morning. I put it on the screen and I put it in different languages. Is there room in your life for Jesus Christ? or is it so overcrowded? Y a-t-il la place dans votre vie pour Jésus-Christ, or est-il si surpeuplé? Is there room for Jesus Christ in your life? In the book of Matthew, chapter 9, verse 23, we are told that when Jesus went to Jairus' house, where his daughter was dead. Notice something. When Jesus came into the ruler's house, he saw them playing the funeral music. And the noisy crowd were crying and weeping. They even mocked Jesus Christ because they were overcrowded. They were overcrowded. They even mocked Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. You know, when it comes for music and our people are singing, that this is remind me back home in Africa. This is how we bury people. We sing. We are not silent at all. We are not, we do sing. We sing louder. Actually, some of the people are Christians. The choir can even come to your home and spend the whole night singing. So here comes Jesus and found the whole crowd. The place was overcrowded with funeral songs, overcrowded with weeping, depression, all kind of sorrow going on in the house. And the Bible says in verse 24, Jesus said, "You need to make room for the girl. It is not dead, but sleeping." Watch what happened. When they made room, the next verse, 25, it says, when the crowd was put outside, did you see that? Outside. He went in. Jesus started doing the work. But he started doing the work when the crowd was outside. Jesus is saying to you, my brothers and sisters in Christ, Jesus needs some room to work in your life because your life is overcrowded. I put it on the screen there, sister. Yep. Jesus Christ needs some room to work in our life because our life is so overcrowded. Make room for Jesus Christ. He's trying to get depression out of your life. He's trying to get weeping out of your life. Jesus is trying to get weeping out of your marriage, weeping out of your house. Jesus is trying to do it. But until you make a room, he's trying to get the doubt of the life of the church. Oh God, I can't believe it. The church people, believers, they are the first people who are doubters. We doubt too much within the power of the Holy Spirit, thinking that the Holy Spirit will never do the work of healing. Jesus is saying, make room in the church because I want to do some miracles in the church. He wants to do some miracles, but they are full of doubt in our churches. He's trying to get defeat and death out of your house, in your family. But you are so overcrowded. You are so overwhelmed with the things of the world. When Jesus Christ put the crowd outside, and the Bible says he took her by the hand, and the girl rose from the dead. I wonder this morning what we are missing from Jesus Christ with a crowded life. Jesus is saying, somebody need to make room for me this morning. Someone need to make room. You are entangled with the care of this life. But if you will make room for me, Jesus, in the morning and go and pray. I put it there. And go and pray. And if you make room for me, Jesus, and open up the Bible and read it, not hold it, read it. If you make room for me and love me more than any tiny seed on Sunday, then you'll see me coming in. But during your week, daily, you will come to me for daily bread. I will begin to bless you. Hallelujah. I will make the limits of what I will do if I become first in your life. I will give you everything you need. When we make Jesus Christ first in our lives, it will give us everything we need. The only challenge that Jesus had was to make room for the miracle. People were put out and the miracle started. Sometimes we have to put some people out of our lives. Sometimes we have to make that decision to put some people out so that to make room for Jesus Christ. I said it in this way. Sometimes you have to say to people, you are important, but Jesus Christ is most important. Amen? That opportunity is good, but Jesus Christ is more important. We are overcrowded with worldly stuff. I remember I had a best friend. You're going to see his picture. The next month I'm going to share the picture that when I went to Congo. I had a best friend. Some of you don't have best friend. Yeah, I've heard them, but I had one. I mean it. And that best friend of mine, he took care of my wife, Corinne, when I was here for 3 years. And my wife was in Africa. She used to go and see him. But we used to drink with our best friend. Everything he did, I did it. Everything, I did it. And we used even to change clothes, you know. Back home, my mom used even to give him my food. And my mom will cook food and leave food for Eric. He's not at home. But he show up at my house and say, Mama, where's Eric's food? And he ate my food. By the time I came home, I said, where's my food? Your friend has eaten. I went to his house as well. I had his food. We used to be best friends. We're not far away from each other. But what I'm saying is this. There was a year when I moved from Congo to Zimbabwe, when I gave my life to Jesus Christ. In other words, when I made room for Jesus Christ. I said, Jesus, number one. And after a couple of years, I went back home. I found my friend doing the same thing we used to do. He came home so excited. He said, well, let's go and drink. I used to drink all this kind of beer. And he said, let's go and drink. And he was home at my house, my mom, my dad when he was alive, and my sisters, they were all there. And I looked at him, I said, my brother, I love you. There's no room for beer anymore. There's a room for Jesus Christ. If you love me, then you have also to walk like me. You can go and drink, but not me. I'm not going to do it. He was so mad. I said, thank you, Jesus. Sometimes I have to make decisions. I said to him, Jesus is most important than you. You have to go, friend. There are times in life you have to tell to your friends and best friend that Jesus is most important. Not Jesus as a tiny, tiny things on Sunday. Thank God we just went to Africa. In June, the same friend of mine, he came home, and I was just thinking about, you want me to order beer for you? I said, no, I don't drink. I said, wow, praise the Lord. What is happening? And it was not me. It was that guy. He made room. That friend of mine made room. He drinks only water. That's all. And he drinks only water. My wife can witness that. I was, wow. Make room for Jesus Christ. Amen. We need a spiritual house cleaning, my brothers and sisters in Christ, where we make room for Jesus Christ in our house, in our lives, in our homes again. We make room for him in our families. We make room for him in our marriages. We make room for him in our relationship. Make room for Jesus Christ. You need to make room for him. He wants to put seed in your life, Jesus. that will guide you and direct you, anoint you and bless you and prosper you. But if your life is so overcrowded with the worldly stuff, how do you expect the Jesus to come in and do the seeding in you? You want to be prospered? Make room for Jesus. You want to have your life directed by the Lord? Make room for Jesus Christ. It shocks the power of the word and out, and you have no idea what you are missing, folks. Everything we are going after in this world, we are going after peace, we are going after joy, happiness, and children, and job, and wife, and husband, and healing, and justice. I can go on and on and on. Everything we are after in this world, we will find it in Jesus Christ. Because Jesus said it in the book of Matthew chapter 6, verse 33. Listen to what Jesus said. Seek first the kingdom of God. In other words, make room first for me, and everything shall be added unto you. What does that mean, everything? Children shall be added unto you. Job shall be added unto you. Peace shall be added unto you. Everything shall be added unto you until you make room for Jesus Christ first. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We are overcrowded with people. We are overcrowded with fun, entertainment, and appointment, all this stuff. Sometimes I feel it as your pastor. The whole week, sometimes I feel it because, they call you here, you pick up the phone, meetings, and I feel like, where is the time for Jesus? I don't have time for Jesus. Sometimes I have to turn off my phone and hide myself because I need room for Jesus Christ. I close this message with this gospel according to the book of John 18. Listen to what Jesus said. It's not me, Jesus. Jesus said, if therefore, he told them, if you seek me, let these things get away. Let some stuff go if you are seeking. If you're after me, then let some other stuff to go. In other words, Jesus is saying, if I'm what you are searching, when you find me, you have to let some other things go. Let things go and make room for me. Sometimes you have to choose, am I going to have room for Jesus? Is he going to be number one in my life? Or am I going to get up and caught up in the care of this life and this sinfulness of temporary stuff that choked out my passion and my love for God? There is a shocking that can come when you begin to get into things more than you have more than when you get into Jesus. We are always after more. More business, more opportunities. Nothing wrong with that. Oh, God, let me tell you, there's nothing wrong with all this more opportunity. We are put here on earth. We are put here to be productive and winning successful people. But the truth is, when it gets out of proportion, suddenly the word of God is nothing but a tiny seed. Prayer becomes a tiny thing in your house. You don't even pray at home. Prayer becomes, I'll pray. Prayer becomes a tiny thing. Going to church and going to the Bible study are just little things. Can you come to Bible study? Reading the Bible at home, praying at home, and worshiping God during the week when you are doing dishes, you are doing amazing grace. When you are doing dishes, when you are doing something, you are dancing for the Lord. Hallelujah. It becomes a tiny portion of your life, and all of the stuff of the world become a big deal to us. Checking Amazon. What are they selling? What are they selling? Anything on sale today? Anything on sale? Anything? Give room for Jesus Christ. The enemies are after us. YouTube, Facebook, the whole day, Instagram, Twitter. Oh, God, Jesus, help us. Oh, God, you are overcrowded, friend. Get out of that stuff. I dare you today, you will say, God, forgive me. Today you're going to say, God, forgive me. Here is my house. Here is my car. Here is my dreams. Here is my aspiration, my career, my desire, and everything I'm working on, because they become too big in my life and you become too little. You pray, you give it to God. There is a saying that says this. This is very powerful. He says this: ships do not sink because of the water around them. Ships sink because of the water that get in them. In other words, it is the same with us as followers of Jesus Christ. If Jesus Christ is not bigger inside us, then we are not powerful. If we let stuff take place of Jesus Christ, my friend, we will sink anytime. We will sink anytime. If we let worldly stuff take place of the Bible, take place of prayer, take place of worship, I guarantee you, no matter what you're going to do, you will sink, including me. If we let those stuff, Paul said this. I did not put it on the screen. Paul said this: greater the one is in me than the one is in this world. By the way, Paul was an educated person. He had opportunities and opportunities. But he realized, he said, Jesus first in my heart, in my life, and the rest will come after. Make room for Jesus Christ. Our life has been so crowded. I'm inviting Brother Jacob to come up here. No room for miracle, no room for prayer in our lives, no room for fasting. Make room this week. You don't have to wait for Pastor Eric to come up and say, we are going to fast the church. No, make room. 1 week, you said, I'm going to fast this week. I'm going to fast. I'm not going to eat anything today. I'm fasting for our nation. I'm fasting for my neighbor. I'm not going to eat breakfast. I'll eat only lunch. I'm praying for my neighbor. I'm praying for my nation. I'm praying for my family. Make room for fasting. Make room for reading the Bible. Sit down and read it. Make room, my brothers and sisters in Christ. Make room for miracle. Make room for regular church attendance. Make room. Come to church. Make room. Hallelujah. The biggest joy is not about getting this and getting that. The biggest joy must be Jesus Christ first. Having Jesus Christ and knowing Jesus Christ is the biggest joy of my life. And it must also be a bigger joy for all believers. Make room for Jesus Christ, my brothers and sisters in Christ. Amen. Amen. I don't know, my brothers and sisters in Christ. Maybe somehow you had room for other things. You are sitting where you are. You know, don't worry about the person sitting next to you. You know God is speaking to you. You know that this is really God's word to me. If you are the person, don't worry about anything here, my friend. Let me tell you, there's always a celebration when somebody stands up and says, Lord, I need help. Amen. Amen. If you are the one, you are overcrowded with appointment, overcrowded with opportunities, overcrowded with this and that, and the world is after you every day, and Jesus is a tiny thing during the week. Not only Sunday where we lift up our hand and pray, but during the week, Jesus is just a tiny thing. You pray when you want it. You're just wishing and longing. If you are the one that you need prayer, I'm inviting you. Amen. I'm inviting you to raise up your hand. Hallelujah. Raise up your hand and say, Lord, oh Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God. And I'm inviting you to stand up. Those who raise up their hand, don't worry about the person sitting next to you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. And then I'm inviting you, if you are able to come up here. Come up here, my brothers and sisters. Just walk up and come up here. We're going to pray for you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Don't worry about the person. I'm telling you, if you're overcrowded, you know that this is me. I need Jesus. I need Jesus. I need to make room for Jesus Christ. I'm inviting you to stand up here. Just walk and walk. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, yes, the Lord. Hallelujah. Oh, yes, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Brothers and sisters in Christ, as you stand here, make that room. Make that prophetic prayer today and say, Lord Jesus, I give my life to you. And I want you to be first in my life. I want you to be first in my life every single day. Hallelujah. Precious God, Heavenly Father, holy and living God, a day like this was known by you, Father. And I give praise and honor unto you for what you have done in the life of my brothers and sisters in Christ. Lord, they are here. I pray according to the word, your word. You said it is not by might, by strength, it is by the power of the Holy Spirit. I pray for the power of the Holy Spirit, God, to be centered in each and every soul here on this altar in the name of Jesus Christ. Father, let their lives be rooted with you and in you in the name of Jesus Christ. Lord, I silence, oh God, any crowdedness that's surrounding their lives from now on in the name of Jesus Christ. I pray for the life of Jesus Christ to be centered in their lives in the name of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah, Jehovah. Merci, Seigneur. Thank you, Jesus. I want you to repeat after me. You pray this prayer after me, my brothers and sisters in Christ. Lord Jesus, I thank you for today. I give my life to you. You will become number one in my life. And the rest of the things will be second. Lord Jesus, come in me. I have a room for you. I have a room for you. In Jesus' name, we pray together and we say it, amen. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Go to Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. As Jacob is singing, I'm inviting you also to give whatever you have brought to the Lord Jesus Christ. Make a room in your life and say, Lord, I have a room for giving. This is what I brought for you. Those who are watching online, they do the same. You can give online. You can send your check to our church. Jacob is singing, and I'm inviting you to stand.
as an anchor for my soul. Through every storm, I will hold to you. His endless love, oh, your name is higher, your name voice it thundered. The oaks start twisting. The forest sounds with cedars breaking. The waters see you and start their riding. And from the depths a song is rising. And now it's rising from the ground. Now are trembling. The creation sees you and starts composing. The fields and trees, they start rejoicing. And now it's rising from the ground. And now it's rising from the ground.
Okay, that's a yes, I know. But another question is, are you ready to make room for Jesus?
Yes, sir.
Uh-huh. Praise the Lord. Those who are watching online, are you ready to make room for Jesus? Yes. Not only Sunday. Not only Sunday, make a room for Jesus Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. Amen. Hallelujah. He created 6 days, including seven. That means every day belongs to Him. Amen. Amen. There's no such things called Sundays, the day of God. God is every day.
Amen, Pastor.
Amen? There's nothing like that. You say, God is only a Sunday God. No, God is every day. Amen? All right. Folks, those who are signing up food, make sure you go back there, you write your name, and your name, how many you are. You know, folks, right? For those who are here for the first time, we are now providing this. You can see in your pews, welcome. You can write prayer requests and give it to me after. Your name, what is your name? How old you are, and how did you hear about our church? It's fine. You don't need even to put your age. There's no problem. But may God really bless you. Let us receive benediction. Hallelujah. Let me say this. If there's anyone who hasn't received a backpack, il y a quelqu'un qui a besoin de quoi, le mallette, de l'école, il faut me voir. après église. See me after church, okay? Hallelujah. Let us receive benediction. My sister, thank you, God. My brothers and sisters in Christ, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Amen. Go in peace and make room for Jesus Christ. All right, I'll see you those folks. I'll see you next week. May God bless you.
Yours.